Good evening, brethren. Good to see everybody. If you'd like to be opening up your Bibles to 2 Peter chapter 2, we'll be looking at the destructiveness of false teachers. The first three verses of 2 Peter chapter 2, we'll read them together. But there were false prophets also among the people, even as there shall be false teachers among you, who privily shall bring in damnable heresies, even denying the Lord that bought them, and bring upon themselves swift destruction. And many shall follow their pernicious ways, by reasons of whom the way of the truth shall be evil spoken of. And through covetousness shall they with feigned words make merchandise of you, whose judgment now of a long time lingereth not, and their damnation slumbereth not. We'll start with verse 1. Notice there were false prophets also among the people. These are not blind leaders of the blind. Now I'm going to try something here that I hopefully will work. We'll go over to Esword and look at Matthew chapter 15. If you'd read along with me, Matthew, this is the Esword Bible program. I highly recommend it. I've been recommending it to you for years. It's free, will not cost you anything. Many Bibles, many commentaries, many dictionaries. I would be happy to give you a personal tutorial over the program if you were to download it, but I highly recommend it. And it's something that I use just about every day, in fact, every day. It says in Matthew 15, 1, then came Jesus, the scribes and Pharisees, which were of Jerusalem, saying, why do thy disciples transgress the tradition of the elders? You see, they had these things they were used to doing. It says, they wash not their hands when they eat bread. Now, they were not talking about hygiene. They were not talking about, you know, somebody, you know, you tell your children, go wash your hands for lunch or supper. That's not what they're talking about at all. They're talking about a ceremonial washing where they would take water about half an eggshell full, and they would take and run a little bit about each finger, and it was a ceremonious thing that they would go through to cleanse themselves. By chance, they had passed or met a Gentile or touched a Gentile in the marketplace or something of that nature. This was strictly a tradition of a holiness, if you will, a rite that they had created. But he answered, notice Jesus doesn't even touch that. He answered and said unto them, why do you also transgress the commandment by your tradition? For God commanded, saying, honor thy father and mother, and let he that curses father and mother, let him die the death. But ye say, whosoever shall say his father and mother, it is a gift. Mark uses the very word they would use, which they would call it korban. C-O-R-B-A-N is how Mark's account has it. They could just take this money that their father or mother may need food or something, and they could take that money and say, oh, well, I'm korban, I'm giving it to the temple, and they would be relinquished of that duty that they had to take care of their parents. And Jesus says, that's flat out wrong. They asked him, why are you breaking the traditions? And Jesus turns right around and says, why are you breaking the command of God? Because of your traditions. It says in verse 5, but you say, whosoever shall say to his father or mother is a gift, by whatsoever thou mightest be profited by me, and honor not his father or his mother, shall be free. Thus you have made the commandment of God of none effect by your tradition. God said, honor your father and mother, and you're saying you don't have to. Verse 7, you hypocrites, well did Isaiah prophesy of you, saying, this people draweth nigh unto me with their mouth and honoreth me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. In vain they do worship me, teaching for doctrine the commandments of men. Vain worship is what these people were offering because they were teaching their own righteousness, as Paul would say in Romans chapter 9. He called the multitude and said unto them, hear and understand, not that which goeth into the mouth defileth a man, but that which cometh out of the mouth, this defileth a man. See, they had been really caught up in their dietary restraints, and that was a good thing. There were certain things they were not supposed to eat. There were certain things they were supposed to eat. And Jesus says the truth of the situation is that what goes into the man is not really what's destroying him. That's what's going to be passed through the drought, he'll say in other accounts. But what defiles a man is that which comes from his heart, that which comes from his mouth. Then came his disciples, the ones that traveled with Jesus, and said unto him, knowest thou that the Pharisees were offended after they heard this saying? He answered and said, every plant, which my heavenly Father hath not planted, shall be rooted up. Let them alone. They be blind leaders of the blind, and the blind lead the blind. Both shall fall into the ditch. These people could not see the truth because just as Paul will describe in the book of 2 Corinthians, their faces were veiled. Their eyes were veiled. They could not see past what they had been doing for years and the tradition of the elders that they had piled on top of the law of God. God had said, okay, don't do this, and they had built hedges around it and had all these kind of obscure traditions that God never intended to be bound upon people. They were binding them, and Jesus says they're blind leaders, and if the blind lead the blind, they're both going to fall into the ditch. This is not what we have taking place in 2 Peter chapter 2. These are far more sinister. These false teachers know exactly what they do. They have an agenda, as we shall see as we go on. There were false prophets, notice also among the people he's talking about in times past. There were guys who were not what they were supposed to be. The word that's used here in the Greek is pseudo-prophetes, which means just simply false prophets. Pseudo, false, or untrue. Prophetes is prophets, the word ones that speak for another. In contrast, remember we looked at last week, 2 Peter chapter 1, 20 and 21, where he says these guys didn't come up with the real prophets, didn't come up with the prophecy of their own, but they were moved by the Holy Spirit. And so these are in contrast. Chapter 2 is a contrast of what that ended up in chapter 1. Those were real prophets. They were moved by the Holy Spirit. They taught the truth, but there's going to be false prophets. There were false prophets in the Old Testament. There will be false prophets in the New Testament. Just very quickly through your mind, you can go back and you can remember false prophets. Do you remember when Ahab wanted to go to war and he was trying to convince Jehoshaphat to go up with him? He had over 400 prophets there with him that would say, yeah, man, go up. You're going to have a great day. One of them even grabbed a pair of horns and was running around saying, boy, you're just going to push those old Assyrians around just like somebody pushing these folks around with a horn. Then, of course, Micaiah come on the scene and says, if you go up there, you're going to die. And, of course, we can think of many. During Jeremiah's time, there were false prophets who would look Jeremiah, who even would smack Jeremiah and talk about and take Jeremiah's yoke off and break his yoke. These were false prophets, pseudo prophets, if you will. They happened in the Old Covenant. We should not be surprised if there are false teachers and false prophets today. Notice who also among the people, even as there shall be false teachers. Same breakdown, pseudo didaskalos, a false teacher, someone who is teaching that which is not right, who privily shall bring in. These guys are not going to walk through the front door with a sign around their neck saying, I'm a false teacher, or they're not going to walk in really with lambskin over and you can see the big snout of the wolves sticking out of their face. That isn't how it works. These guys are going to come in privily. Notice the word that is used here is parasigo. Para means to the side. Esigo is a compound word. Ice means unto, ago means to lead into. They're going to come in from the side, not hit you head on. That's not how false teachers work. They come in through the side door. They come in the background. They're privately, they're actually snuck in, if you will. In Galatians 2:4, the very same thing is going on. Paul is writing to the Galatian church. Now, the main thing that Paul is dealing with is Judaizing teachers. And what they want to teach is that Gentiles, before they can become children of God, must be circumcised and they must follow the law of Moses. That's what happens in Acts chapter 15. Paul and Barnabas will take issue with that and say, no, that's not the case. Gentiles do not need to obey the law of Moses. They need to obey the law of Christ. And so there's a big war going on. That's what's happening in Galatians chapter 2. That's what's happening in the book of Galatians. Oh, foolish Galatians, Galatians chapter 3 at verse 1. Who hath bewitched you? They were trying to bring in the law of Moses and bind that upon these new Christians in the churches of the Galatian place. That's the same thing that's happened in the book of Romans. The book of Romans is a treatise, a smaller version of the book of Galatians, if you will, where people were still trying to follow the law. And Paul is trying to show that the law has been done away with. You can't be married to two laws, Romans chapter 7. You can't be under the old covenant and the new covenant at the same time. There's two different priests. There's two different high priests. It won't work. You can't be married to two men, or you'll be an adulteress. You can't be married to two laws. And so the book of Romans, the book of Galatians, he stresses that over and over again. And he even tells the Galatians that the gifts and things that you have, the miraculous preaching you're doing, the healing, did you get that because of the law or did you get that through the Spirit? Notice the Spirit is contrasted with the law, the New Testament with the Old Testament. And of course, they had learned through the New Testament, but there were false teachers coming in telling them, you have got to do this, which you didn't. Remember, they even wanted to circumcise Titus, and Paul said, we didn't put up with that for a second. But notice, and that because of false brethren, unawares, they're snuck in, if you will, brought in, who came in privately. There's our same word, same root word that we're dealing with in 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 1. They sneak in. These are smuggled. This idea here has the idea who've brought in unawares. The unawares there is another take on that asego word. It means to smuggle in. They're smuggled in. And who come in privily, there's our word. They come in the side to spy out our liberty, which we have in Christ Jesus, that they might bring us under bondage. Under bondage to what? The old law, the old covenant. That was their agenda, and that's what they were trying to do. I don't believe that what's taking place in 2 Peter is of that same nature, or particularly in 1 John, as we were looking at this morning in chapter 2 and in verse 4. Paul is really combating the Judaizing teachers. I think you have more of a Gnostic kind of element taken on, particularly with John. No doubt in John, because he's so much into the Antichrists, you know, those who would deny that Jesus has come to flesh, hence Judaism. So the spy out liberty which we have in Christ, that they might bring us under bondage, of course, that's to the old law. But notice the ones that Peter is talking about, who shall bring in damnable heresies. Now, that would include Judaizing teachers if that was the case, but he just doesn't seem to bring that to the forefront as he could. Damnable heresies is a word that in the Greek means to make a choice, that which is chosen, a body of men or following their own tenet. They have decided, hey, listen, this is us. And this is what separates us from that other bunch. And this is our agenda. A manual, a church manual is that idea to a sect. For instance, we have many manuals in our library of denominational doctrine where we have a confession of faiths. We have, the Hitchcock's Baptist manual. We have several manuals back there. And basically what you have a group of people assemble a book, not the Bible. It's separate apart from the Bible, and it's another book, and they say, this is what makes us what we are. Now, if you're going to follow in our tenets, first of all, this starts particularly with the government of the church. The preacher's going to have thus and thus qualifications. He's going to have a degree from a seminary. He's going to have a degree there. He's going to have to, do this and do that, and he's going to have to meet these other things. And so forth, they start setting that. They're going to have the board of deacons and who has to do that and so forth. And that's laid out in these various books. And that's what makes them this particular sect. That's what makes us who we are. You can't have Baptists without a Baptist manual. You can't have Methodists without a Methodist manual because they have to have these governing bodies. If you've ever played any kind of sport, you know how difficult that can be. I remember when I first started playing softball, I had no idea there were 5 governing bodies. And that's a big deal. When you're playing 10 and under softball and this girl takes off and is going to steal second. And I'm going, where is she going? You can't steal second and 10 and under ball. And they're going like, yeah, you can. This is Duke Dixie Youth Girls. And I'd never even heard of that. I grew up playing NSA and ASA. We didn't know. So in that body, you could steal second at 10 and under. So there's different rule books. That's what made the ASA thing, the NSA. We understand that. And that's what folks do today. Now, the Bible uses this when it's talking about the Sadducees. The Sadducees says there's no such thing as angels. There's no such thing as the afterlife. And they pulled themselves out of the body of the Jews, if you will, and said, this is what makes us us, and we're Sadducees. Used to love Roger's description of the Sadducees. They didn't believe in angels nor in the afterlife, so they were sad, you see. I always thought that was pretty neat. The Pharisees, they were called a sect in Acts chapter 15 at verse 5. And they were your orthodox, they were your very extreme to the letter. In fact, they even went beyond the letter and had their own letters, but they were a sect. This is even used disparagingly talking about Christians. Remember when Paul is being accused? They've hired an attorney, if you will, one to speak for them, the Jews have. And he says that Paul is now a part of that sect of the Nazarenes. Well, we know that's not true. The Christians are not a sect. They are Christians. And there was no sect of the Nazarenes, even though they tried to put a label on it. They tried to figure out, where does this come from? And so they called it a sect of the Nazarenes. That's what a heresy is. It's something where somebody makes a choice and says, we're going to teach this. And that's what was happening in the first century with what we call Gnosticism. Gnosticism, you look it up, you're going to get 50,000 different. We don't really know exactly everything that was involved with it, but we do know the powerful movement behind it was saying that Jesus was not God in the flesh, because they would say that physical and spiritual cannot be together at one time. Physical, anything material, is sinful. It's wicked in and of itself, whereas the spiritual is not. And so God could not have put on a physical body, because physical is sinful. And you might say, well, that sounds kind of strange. Listen, brethren, I've told you this before, but I'm telling you the truth. I'll tell you the truth in love. I was taught this. I was taught this at 10 years old when I was trying to figure out, what in the world do you mean once saved, always saved? How can you be saved and sin? When a person sins, they need to fix that, don't they? They can't live a life of sin and still be saved. And I was told that your flesh doesn't affect your spirit. That's Gnosticism. And that's in the year, that's in the 21st century. I was taught that, so don't think it's a dead theology, because it's very much alive. We move on and says, even denying the Lord. That's exactly what the Gnostics were doing. They were saying, Jesus is not God in the flesh. No, he didn't become God until he gave up the Spirit. When he left the cross, then he became God and is sitting on the right hand of God, which is just contrary to everything that's taught in the Bible. Even denying the Lord, what their doctrine promoted, what it produced. And like we said before, this could be Gnosticism. It could be the Antichrist is simply denying that Jesus is God in the flesh. 2 John 1:7 says, many are deceivers, are entered into the world, who confess not that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh. This is a deceiver and an Antichrist. Notice the capitalization. This is from the New King James Version. And like we talked about this morning, don't want to spend a whole lot of time with it. We spent a lot of time in Sunday school with it. There's no authority in the original language for that. It's not capitalized in the original Greek. That is where somebody takes their theology and simply inserts it into the text. And that happens all the time, brethren. And most times it's not a big deal. For instance, back in the Old Testament, when you see the Lord said unto my Lord there, you know, you have the capital L-O-R-D, huge letters. Anytime you see that, that's the King James translators just trying to tell you that is the covenant name of God. That is Yahweh. That is Jehovah. Okay? When you see that in big block letters, L-O-R-D. But you'll know when Jesus says, or the Spirit says, David writes, the Lord said unto my Lord, well, it's smaller. It's capital L. And they're capitals, but they're shorter. O-R-D. That's the Greek, the Hebrew word of kurios. And so they do that just to show you the difference in the words. And there's not a problem with that as long as you understand that going in. Here, I think there's more of a problem because of the false doctrine of premillennialism that goes around, where people are actually looking for this evil world leader who is, you know, basically going to kick off the rapture and the thousand-year reign and all that stuff, which is just, it's just not in the Bible. It's just not there. And this right here, John will even tell you who the Antichrists are. They're those who deny the Christ. And they were there in John's day. He said, they're right here. They're now amongst us. So, don't be looking for that Anwar Sadat or whoever, Saddam Hussein, because it's just not going to happen. Even denying the Lord that bought them. Now, notice what Peter's saying here. These people have been bought. Now, they're doing these things, but these folks have been bought. Folks, who have been bought? The Bible's pretty clear about who's been bought. This is talking about Christians. Think with me now for a moment. 1 Corinthians 6:19. What? Know you not that you're the body is the temple of the Holy Ghost, which is in you, which you have of God, and you are not your own, for you are bought with a price. Who's bought with a price? Christians. Jesus gave up his life. He shed his blood to buy Christians. He gave up his blood to buy the church. Notice Acts 20:28. Take heed therefore unto yourselves and over to all the flock over which the Holy Ghost hath made you overseers to feed the church of God, which he hath purchased with his own blood. There was a purchase price. The church has been bought. Christians have been bought. 1 Peter 1:18. Peter in the first book says, for as much as you know that you're not redeemed with corruptible things, as silver and gold from your vain conversation received by tradition from your fathers, but with the precious blood of Christ. We're bought with the blood of Jesus. So who's being spoken of here? No doubt in my mind, He's talking about Christians. Later on in this very chapter, he'll say, for after they have escaped the pollutions of the world. Folks, how do adults who are in sin, how do people who are old enough that are sinners, how do they escape the pollutions of the world? They obey the gospel. That's what happened with these folks. They had escaped the pollutions of the world through the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. But what happened? They are again entangled thereinto and become and overcome. The latter end is worse from them than the beginning. Of course, we'll look at that more in detail in a few weeks. But what happens here is these folks were Christians, but they've fallen. And some of them become false teachers. Why is their doctrine so destructive? First of all, many will follow. Brethren, I have no idea. I wished I did. But why is false doctrine so popular? I guess it's because you can do just about anything you want to with it. And you don't have to really repent of the things you're doing wrong. You can just kind of work them into your doctrine, you know? If you got problems with alcohol and drugs, you don't have to give it up. You can just find some place that says that's all right. If you got a problem in your marriage or don't even want to get married, just want to live with somebody, just move around, find around. You'll find some place that'll teach it. That's just fine. Go ahead and do that. Many will follow. I guess that's the appeal to it. It says, notice, many shall follow their pernicious ways. It's not just going to be them. Not only that, but the truth is going to be evil spoken of. Notice, by reason of whom the way of truth shall be evil spoken of. Take your mind back to what happened with David. I love David. One of the things I'm making a goal this year, I'm going to try to read the book of Psalms 4 times. I'm in the second one now. And so many of those are written by David. You can see David pour his heart out in those pages. David was a great guy. But he made one mistake that just really sticks out. And it was a bad one. And it just got compounded because he wouldn't face it head on. He tried to work his way around it with Bathsheba. Ended up murdering her husband in a roundabout way. And what happened? Notice what Samuel tells him about that. Excuse me, Nathan. Because by this deed, now this is Nathan standing before David. Remember, he's gave him the parable, the ewe lamb. And David just gets wroth and says, boy, the guy did this, man. He's worthy of death. He's going to pay fourfold. I tell you, he's worthy of death. And Nathan says, thou art the man. And David says, I have sinned. Nathan will say, how be it, because by this deed, thou hast given great occasion to the enemies of the Lord to blaspheme. Because you have lived your life in such a way and you have made this mistake and you've done it open. This is not something that was done in a closet. Brethren, you know as well as I do, there is no way the President of the United States sends for a woman to come to his place and be with him and leaves the next morning and nobody knows about it. You know, a king can't pull that off. He's got to send messengers. Somebody has to bring her. There's going to be time spent together. And she's going to go back home, and there's going to be people that are going to see that. Folks are going to know, and they are going to talk. And then everybody's going to know. This thing was not done on an island. And Nathan says, David, you have given the enemies of God an occasion to blaspheme God. And that, brethren, should be a powerful motivator for us to try to live our lives as best as we can and not give the enemy ammunition to throw up against us and our brethren and to bring shame and reproach on the Lord's church. It should make me, give me more reason not to sin, to live above what the world is living, to do what God would say so that the enemies of the cross can't say, look at Ron Gilbert. He preaches one thing, he does something else. You know, he don't live his life. They're going to say that anyway, a lot of folks will. But at least make it, when they do say that, make it be a lie. Make yourself be evil spoken of by somebody coming up with something. Don't give them things. That's exactly what happened here with David. Thou hast given great occasion to the enemies of the Lord to blaspheme and to talk about the God of heaven. The child also that is born in thee shall surely die. You see what a terrible price that was paid for that. And, you know, I'm really trying to get away from, you know, but when I think of David, that's just one of the first things that pops in my mind. That occasion, that one occasion that just really... Why their doctrines are destructive, first of all, people are quick to point out the division that exists in Christianity. People that are familiar with the Bible at all will tell you, first of all, Jesus said he had to pray that y'all would all be one, and look at you. You're a mess. You can't agree on anything. You've got people over here pouring people. You've got people over here sprinkling people. You've got people over here immersing people. You've got people saying it don't matter what you do, period. You don't even have to fool with it at all. You've got people meeting on Saturday. You've got people meeting on Sunday. You've got people saying you need to say the sinner's prayer. You've got people saying you need to be baptized. You've got some saying you need to pray through. You've got some saying you need to come down and, to the altar. You've got others saying you just need to repent. You've got to call on the name of the Lord. You don't have all that. And that gives them occasion to blaspheme our Lord. People are quick to point out the division that exists in Christianity, and people are quick to point out the sins of Christians. You know that as well as I do. That's why, brethren, we must even try harder to be the kind of people that God would have us to be. What can we look for? Well, first of all, they work in secret. Remember, they come in from the side. Knowing that light dispels all darkness, they will work behind the scenes. They don't want to hit head on. Let me tell you something. If a man will not promote his teaching in public, beware. And I have yet to talk with a man that teaches false doctrine. I have yet to talk with a man that runs with people that teach false doctrine that will stand with you and sit there and talk to you about it. Every man I've gone to talk to that's either with somebody or has taught something false basically just puts it off and doesn't even want to talk about it. If a man will not promote his teaching in public, beware. Verse 3, and through covetousness, they shall with feigned words make merchandise of you. Through covetousness, trained in covetousness, they will allure through it. They'll use it. Verse 14 of this same chapter says, having eyes full of adultery, and that cannot cease from sin, beguiling unstable souls, people who are not set in the Scriptures, people who are vulnerable, people who are still children as far as the Spirit, as far as faith is concerned. They'll use that. How many times have you heard these guys get on television and talk about how this prophecy back here in Ezekiel is talking about the thousand-year reign of Christ, and they don't have a clue? It doesn't touch any part of it. Yet they can throw it out there like that, and most people don't know the Bible from beans, and they don't have a clue. They just listen and go, what sounds good? I'm in. And they don't know. And see, they use that to their advantage to make money, to promote their ministry, usually which is just 9 times out of 10 themselves. And heart they have exercised with covetous practices, cursed children. Verse 18, for when they speak great swelling words of vanity, they allure through the lust of the flesh, through much wantonness or lasciviousness, overflowing lasciviousness. I was reading, Brother Kaufman was writing about a study that was done back in 1974 at a university. They chose like 44 students and 6 faculty members to sit in on something. And they promoted the guy that was going to be speaking that day. He had a PhD in this and an MAB in this and a BS in that. And, I mean, he was something else. And he came in, and what he did was talk about mathematics for 45 minutes. He had illustrations, and he gave just a great speech. And, he had illustrations. I guess he probably had PowerPoint or overhead, whatever was popular in 1974. And it was well done, and he was very positive, and he was forthright and knew what he was talking about and really laid it down. And you know what he was talking about? Absolute nonsense. He didn't have the subject he was talking about didn't exist. The concepts that he laid out there were not true, but he presented it powerfully. He had all these credentials behind his name. And you know how many people of that 50 picked up on it? Not one. In the exit interview, when everybody left, they talked about what a great thing. He seemed to have all his material. He gave enough examples. The man was a hired actor, and they gave him the script to go by. And what his job was just to simply sell it, and he sold it, and everybody in there bid it. And that's just how folks work. That's how people work. But notice here, those that were clean escaped from them who live in error. There were some who were able to get out of it. Trained in covetousness, they will allure through it. They will offer the things that the world desires. Take a look at Trinity Broadcasting sometime. I'm not talking about our little cable channel down here. Just look at that show for a while. Notice how the preachers dress. Notice the jewelry. Notice how the ladies dress. Notice the backgrounds. Notice the musicians. Notice the money that is pumped into that thing. It is well organized. And what do they tell is going to happen? If you send him a check for $1,000, what's the Lord going to do? He's going to send you one back for 10 times that. You can't outgive the Lord, they'll tell you. They're going to promise you wealth. They're going to promise you health. You call them in on their prayer line, send them a certain donation. They're going to pray for you, and you're going to get through whatever health problems you're having. Power, influence, these things. The only question I have, does anybody remember the Apostle Paul? I mean, here we're talking about one of the greatest evangelists that's ever lived. Read his resume sometime. Everywhere he turned, he was getting beat. He was getting run out of town. He didn't have enough money to go from one place to the other. Some brethren in Macedonia were keeping him afloat while he was down in Corinth preaching. Anything but wealth and health and power and influence. As a matter of fact, instead of health, he was given a thorn in the flesh so that he wouldn't be thought of too highly by those to whom he was preaching. They will offer the things that the world desires and people will run with it. Why do you think Joel Osteen is so popular? He's a positive guy, and he tells people what they want to hear, and he uplifts people. Now, brethren, I'd love to be uplifting. I hope that I am from time to time, but I want to tell you the truth. And 2 Peter chapter 2 happens to be in the Bible. And if I'm going to declare unto you the whole counsel of God, it needs to be preached. People need to know that there's false teachers out there, that there are false prophets in the old times. Notice their destructive end. They will bring on themselves swift destruction. The last part of chapter 2. Verse 1, swift destruction. Their doctrines will not only destroy others, but themselves as well. Remember Jim Baker? Remember the kind of the scheme he had with the condo thing right there? And I mean, it just between the alcohol, the wild women. Jimmy Swaggart, remember how it fell apart for him with prostitutes? David Koresh, I mean, how in the world a man can convince another man to give him his daughter when he already has several other wives? The Jim Jones, I mean, how in the world do 800 people fall in that kind of, how does that happen? And yet it happened, and these guys, of course, are the extreme, but this happens on a much smaller level every day. We can probably name congregations here in this area, in this town, that one man runs it, he does what he wants to, and sometimes we've seen them fall. And that even happened in Bible times. I'm not just saying if some man falls, that proves his religion is false. But these fellows, when they do fall, their destruction will be swift. Notice the last part of verse 3. Whose judgment now of a long time lingereth not, and their damnation slumbereth not. God is going to do what God has said. Now, maybe not in our time frame. Maybe not as quickly as we think it ought to fold out or happen. But God's going to take care of it. He's not idle. He's not asleep. He didn't spare the guilty. Notice with me, if you will, if you have your Bibles, in chapter 2, verses 4, he gives us three examples just very quickly. He spared not the angels that sinned, verse 4, cast them down to hell. That word right there is the only word time to find in the New Testament, the word Tartarus. It's not the usual word that we find, Hades. But the angels are there in Tartarus. He didn't spare the people in Noah's day, verse 5. He didn't spare Sodom and Gomorrah. He gave them time. As a matter of fact, you remember he even kind of bartered there with Abraham about Sodom and Gomorrah. He said, if I find 50 people, I won't destroy it. And Abraham said, well, I don't know if he'll do that or not. Let me try to whittle it down here. And they have that conversation. They go to 45, 40, 35, 30. They end up at 10. Abraham says, if you find 10, God says, if I find 10, I won't destroy it. But we realize that God couldn't find 10 people that were righteous. So God did not spare the guilty. He will not spare the guilty, but God doesn't work on our time frame. He may choose to delay judgment. Notice chapter 3, verse 7. The heavens and earth, these folks are going to be talking, trying to say, everything is like it was in the past. Notice Peter says, but the heavens and the earth, which are now, by the same word are kept in store, reserved unto fire against the day of judgment and perdition of ungodly men. But beloved, be not ignorant of this one thing, that one day is with the Lord as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is one day. In other words, God doesn't operate on our schedule. He doesn't do things that we think that we ought to do. When you think back to Abraham, when God was giving Abraham the land of Canaan, talking about this is going to be your seeds, they're going to have it all, how many of us would think that 430 years might be a little long to give a people a chance to repent, to give the Amorites time to turn it around? God says, I'm not going to give it to you now, because the wickedness of the Amorites is not yet full. In other words, people living there, they still got some time. I'm going to give them time to repent. 430 years, folks. Now, you do the math. A generation usually lasts about 20 years, so you have about five generations in a century. And so you do, four centuries there times five generations. We're talking 21 and a half, 22 generations God gave these people to repent. That's not how I work. Generally, I'll watch an old boy a couple weeks, a couple of days, man. We'll see if he improves. God watched him for 400 years. That's not how me and you work. So when we see these false doctrines, false teachers and things, and we're saying, boy, they're going to get his one day. They will. Maybe not in this life, but certainly in the one to come. He may choose to delay judgment. That's God's hand. His almighty omniscience. He decides the time is right. It will be swift. Verse 10 of that same chapter says, the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, in which the heavens and the earth will pass away with great noise, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat. The earth also and the works that are therein shall be burned up. It'll take place. God is not going to forget. He's not idle. He's not asleep. But as we saw in verse 9 earlier today, he's long-suffering for me and you. And we might say, well, you know, these people need to pay. Think back in your life. I can think back in my life when there was a time I needed to pay. But thanks be to God that I was given time and opportunity to repent, to turn away from my sins, to do what I ought to do. Can't all of us say that? And so when we're thinking about, boy, it's high time God did something, just thinking about what if it had been high time for God to do something when you were needing that long-suffering. And maybe that'll help us appreciate the long-suffering of God. This is not the end of Peter's discourse of false teachers, just the beginning, really. He's going to dedicate this entire chapter to this very topic. We've been warned of false teachers, brethren. God warns us for a reason. If there were no such things as false doctrine today, false teachers, people being led astray, then God would not have wasted his time and my time and your time filling up the Bible with all these warnings. They're there and they're sincere and they're for real. Bottom line is, I am responsible for my soul. You are responsible for your soul. The elders of this congregation are responsible not only for their souls, but ours as well. That's why they're in charge of feeding the congregation, to make sure that what comes from this pulpit is sound food, and that when the congregation eats, it eats good food and can be and can grow up spiritually. God has warned us for a reason. That stands for every eldership up and down this valley and throughout the earth. They're responsible too, and we need elders. And that starts here. We've got to train young men to know what the doctrine is, to know what the truth is, so that when they hear it not being proclaimed, they can stop, stand up, and stop the mouths of the gainsayers. Titus chapter 1. That hasn't been done a lot, and we're reaping what we have sown. We must continue in the apostles' doctrine. What is that apostles' doctrine? Acts 2:42, they continue steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and in fellowship and in breaking of bread and prayers. That's how we do it today. We do what the apostles taught us, and they taught us through the word. They taught us through the writing, the men who wrote inspired. Notice in John 14:16, Jesus said, I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another comforter, that's the Holy Spirit, that he may abide with you forever. We have that word right here. We can continue in the apostles' doctrine because we have it written down for us. But brethren, we've got to be people of the book. We've got to know the book, and we've got to encourage each other. Jesus said, judge not according to the appearance. Don't look at something. Hollywood right now will sell you on so much wickedness. I mean, they even make it look pretty. They can take two fellas that are in a lifestyle that God says is abominable, and by the end of the show, they can make you think, oh, they were so good for each other. You know, they can twist it, and they do that all the time to try to make something that's wicked to appear to be something it's not. Jesus says, don't judge according to appearance, but judge righteous judgment. What's that mean? Test the spirits. Judge righteous judgment. What's the Bible say? And you can make an adulterous marriage, a homosexual marriage, or anything like that look pretty. But the bottom line is, what does God say about it? What does God say about the wickedness of killing the unborn? You can make it look as pretty as you want. Saw an advertisement that's being used up in New York City. My sister-in-law sent it to my wife. It was a picture of a little baby. He was cuter and everything. He ain't wasn't a really baby, though. He had a whole head full of Goldilocks, you know. So I'm saying he must have been like two or three, and he was just crying up a storm. You see him, big tears rolling down his eyes. And he said, if you had me as a teenager, there's a 50% chance that I won't graduate from high school. And what it is, it's an ad for teenagers to get abortions, family planning, they call it. And I wanted just to be able to write back and send it out and say, if you kill me when I'm in your womb, there's a 100% chance that I will not graduate high school. There's a 100% chance that I will never even take the first breath. But you see, you can paint anything up and you can make it look just as ugly as you want, but it doesn't change the truth. Killing babies is wrong. I don't care if he doesn't graduate from high school. At least he'd have a chance. At least he'd have a chance. We need to protect them babies. Don't judge according to appearance, but judge righteous judgment. The plan of salvation is very simple, brethren. I'm looking at this audience. I think just about everybody here is a child of God. If you're not, let me encourage you to obey the gospel. Very plain, simple plan of salvation. You've heard the gospel. Simply obey it. Repent of your sins. Confess that Jesus is the Christ. And put him on in baptism. And then you can be a New Testament Christian, a child of God. And then start that walk. Most of the time, what we have happening in the church is that most of us, sometimes we're at different places in our life spiritually. We kind of move around. And we sometimes allow things to creep in our lives and get and push Jesus and push God out of that first place in our lives. Don't do that. Don't let the world choke out your spirituality, those weeds that we read about in the parable of the sower. Put God where he needs to be. If it's something publicly, if you need the prayers of the church, we'll do anything that we can to help. If you're in need at all, would you come as together we stand and sing.